Caroline Jones. Welcome to our final Australian story for this year. Annabel Blake grew up with a mother who, as a young athlete, was hoping to represent Australia at the Winter Olympics. Janine Shepherd raised her children to follow their passions, demonstrating through her own extremely challenging life that nothing is impossible. Now, in a surprising twist, Annabel is reaching for the goal so cruelly denied to her mother. And this is their story.
I always tell my girls that, you know, if you're not living on the edge, you're taking up too much space. I think that that sense of adventure is something that I've been able to pass on to them.
The biggest gift Mum has given me is that I have this innate belief that absolutely anything is possible.
Annabel's discipline is slope style, which is a new discipline. They actually go down a run. They have three park features like rails and then three jumps. You know, it's totally crazy sport.
Lots of crashes, knocked my head quite a bit, broke my helmet, broke my bones. So if you're gonna add a jump or a metal rail into the middle of it, you're definitely asking for trouble. This upcoming Winter Olympics in Russia is the first time slopestyle is going to be an Olympic event. I would really love to qualify for the Sochi Olympic Games.
I had a dream once to go to the Winter Olympics, and it was my concern that perhaps Annabel thought she needed to get to the Olympics for me.
A lot of people say, oh, you want to go to the Olympics and follow in your mum's footsteps. In no way is my dream to go to the Olympics her dream. It's my own. In my sport, injury is kind of unavoidable. I dislocated my elbow. I tore my ACL, so I had to have a reconstruction on that knee. I broke my ankle on the trampoline. I then tore my stomach muscles doing gym rehab, so I spent my 21st birthday in hospital. There's been a lot of my friends that have had injuries far worse off than mine. When I was in Breckenridge this winter, a few people I know broke their backs. For me, the reality of the consequences really hits home because I live with someone with a disability every day.
A lot of people in Australia already know my story.
She was the fittest woman athlete in Australia and our best hope for gold at the Winter Olympics. An accident smashed her body, her sporting aspirations, and it seemed her life. Against the odds, Janine Shepherd has claimed back her life.
It's like a time warp. You know, it's like a bad dream. It's a nightmare.
I've had a lot of media appearances. Claudia Carvin played me in the movie Never Tell Me Never.
I mean, I should be a lot stronger now. I still can't feel my feet.
The damage to the spinal cord had already been done.
And I've also written three memoirs.
13 years ago, Janine Shepherd was a champion cross-country skier.
I've had a public life for a long time and the kids have sort of grown up with that as well. And people often ask me, what do your kids think about your role and what you do? And I go, I'm their mum. I'm just their daggy mum.
She is the toughest woman I've ever met. Everybody is competition to her, you know, whether it be in speaking circles, whether it be other authors. If you're competing in the same circles as Janine, you'd want to be good or get out of the road because she'll be coming straight through.
All the people that were there on that shift were at Oxley.
Everybody that works there.
And it means, well, almost, there's a couple of others, but it means that every time there's a big school week like Olay, they have no one working.
For Charlotte and Annabel and Angus, they would probably all say that it's not easy being, you know, Janine's child. Because, yeah, you've got to live up to expectations.
So you won't see Annabel again. She's going in 2 weeks.
I'd be doing cross-country carnivals when I was younger. And, like, all the parents are standing on the sidelines and stuff and cheering on their kids, and my mum would always be standing at the hilly section. And I'm getting tired, and then I'd hear mum from this, like, crowd of parents being like, feel the pain, love the hills. And I'm like, does anyone know whose parent that is? Like, everyone's like, whose parent is that? And she's like, love the pain. And I'm like, not mine. Because she's crazy, because nobody loves the hills.
When I was very young, I would go out training on the hills. I would just push myself, absolutely push myself to the limit. I discovered that the hills never stopped. Once you were over one hill, there was always another one there waiting for you. But as soon as I accepted that, then I learnt to love them. Once you accept that life has hills, then the fact that it has hills doesn't matter anymore.
I guess one of the biggest lessons that you sort of get from mum is perseverance. So, I mean, she's always had huge goals in life, and some people might say, I mean, you can't do it. I mean, it's not possible, but she's just always believed that she can do anything. And sometimes it's a bit scary, but I think she actually can.
I was a tomboy. I started my athletics career at the age of, I think, 6 or 7 with little athletics. And to me, that was, I mean, I lived for it. I was very competitive. Race walking came in at that stage and I became the Australian champion.
Oh, Janine was always very stubborn, very driven, always expected to be perfect at everything she did and expected everyone else to be exactly the same as that. She was never happy with coming second best.
Alan, I'm right behind you.
Lighten up, Janine. So bloody competitive.
They always call her Janine the Machine.
Janine the Machine. That'll stick.
She became New South Wales triathlon champion. She went from triathlons to the cross-country ski team at Macquarie University and then realised that she had a chance at competing at the Calgary Olympics, Winter Olympics, and that's what her goal was at that time.
It was someone who I thought was perhaps the most exciting prospect to come onto the Australian skiing scene in a long, long time.
The day of my accident, we were riding from Sydney to the Blue Mountains, which is around a 6-hour ride.
Feeling okay, Machine?
Yeah, still a bit jet-lagged.
A speeding utility truck was driving up the hill and he said he didn't see me. My last memory was just looking up and seeing the sun shining in my face and then everything went black. And that's the moment that changed my life forever. I broke my neck and my back in 6 places. I broke 5 ribs on my left side, head injuries, internal injuries and massive blood loss.
Janine, you need this to breathe.
I can't even begin to describe the level of pain that I was in. I remember I had a choice. I could let go and the pain would be gone. And I knew what that meant. It was almost as if there was an anchor or something tying me to the earthly life. And it wasn't until later that I was told that Dad was sitting by my bed holding my hand. And he would later tell me that he was giving me his strength. And that was what kept me connected to this life. I really believe that that was my lifeline.
They really thought they were going to lose her at the time. And then the doctor said to her parents that she wouldn't walk again, she wouldn't have children. I mean, she was lucky to even be alive at that point.
She had a comminuted or shatter fracture of her spine at multiple levels, and the spinal cord was either cut or compressed in various parts too. She needed surgery to stabilise the spine and to give her the best possible chance for the future.
One of my doctors came in after the operation and said, you know, Janine, you know, the operation has been a success. I had no feeling from the waist down, so she said, you know, you might get 10 or 20% return of that feeling. You're what we call a partial paraplegic and you're going to have all the injuries that go along with that.
There's nothing really to do, just lie on your back.
I spent almost 6 months in hospital, so I guess I had a long time for it to sink in.
When I got home from hospital, I was terribly, terribly depressed. There were days when I thought, gosh, I wish... Oh, my God, why didn't you take me? You know, why do I have to be here going through this?
I came to a point where everything came crashing down around me. And that was a really seminal moment because I let go of the belief that I would ski again, that my body would be the same body that I had. Letting go and surrendering was the point of possibility.
The Olympic Games for her was her whole life. And when she missed out, coupled with her injuries, it was devastating. It rocked her world. She had to recreate it herself, recreate the way she lived and the way she looked at the world.
I taught myself to walk. I had enough muscle strength in my upper legs to walk around the house holding onto the walls. So what next? And an aeroplane flew over the house. And I looked up and I thought to myself, that's it, I'm gonna learn to fly.
She ended up getting her commercial pilot's license and flying, and she did that for a while and was an instructor, an aerobatics instructor actually.
Flying was the ultimate freedom. You know, I didn't need to be able to use my legs. So it was that, you know, it was a great metaphor for that, you know, for that sense of freedom.
And it wasn't long before she decided that she was going to put her story down, and she wrote the book Never Tell Me Never.
To replace everything that I'd lost, what could I do? I couldn't even walk.
So that started my speaking career, which I had no idea where that was going to go to. I met Tim when I was working at Sydney Aerobatic School at Bankstown. He was also a flying instructor there. You know, he's a genius. And, you know, it was never boring. We were a great team. Living with Tim was so easy.
He was very much the sort of guy that would be able to handle whatever you threw at him. And Janine was one of those things. You know, she's not the easiest person in the world to live with. She has very high expectations of herself and other people and things around her. Janine was certainly told in hospital that she'd be unlikely to conceive and have children. Being Janine, she proved them wrong.
I had difficulties with my pregnancies. I had a lot of back pain, but I had 3 normal births, so I was very, very grateful for that.
This is Bong Bong Farm, as you could see.
When we were 10, we moved to Barrow and we moved onto a farm and I loved it. Got to be the most feral child. I think that is in part where I learnt to deal with pain.
Chickens don't come out the big gate.
We had a bungee jumping tree where we used to pull down this big branch, you'd sit on it, you'd fling yourself up. We had a few injuries with that. Had motorbikes. Horses, knocked myself out on those a few times.
Annabel, I'm sure anyone would tell you, she's a little bit crazy. A lot of people say that I seem like the older sister, and I'm even taller, so I guess that helps as well. But no, I've always been a little bit more serious. I think she got in trouble a little bit throughout high school.
In high school, I was diagnosed with ADHD. I would say that's something I've struggled with, but I've generally had a pretty good outlook on it. I definitely saw it as an advantage, not a disadvantage. I did swimming and I was on the Talented Athlete program for triathlon. So sport was the only thing that kind of kept me in check, use all my endless, boundless energy. But skiing I loved more than anything else. I remember watching a ski movie when I was about 15 and there was a girl that did a backflip in this movie. And I was like, Mom, that girl just did a backflip. I can do a backflip.
This is my favourite part of the video, the little cartoony bit.
So I flew to Canada on the same day as my last HSC exam and worked full-time as a lifty, and on my weekends I skied. And that's when I knew I wanted to keep doing it.
Have you learned to spin both ways yet?
Yeah.
There must be tricks that
nobody's done yet.
Yeah, some girls are doing doubles. They're pretty sick.
She's had the longest gap year around. She took 1 year off, and I think it's turned into five. So she travels the world following the snow.
Slopestyle skiing is a modern evolution of freestyle skiing. It's like a skate park on snow. Participants put together basically a routine. It's all about style and creativity. Someone that loves adventure and someone that's willing to push themselves out of their comfort zone.
Like your body's screaming no or your head's screaming no and you have to turn around and be like, yes. I want to do a trick and my body's like, oh, hell no. My brain's like, we shouldn't be doing this. It's going, no, Annabel, remember the last time we did this and you ended up in hospital and it really hurt? We shouldn't do that again. And I'm going, yeah, we're going to do it again. We're going to do it right now. I don't care what you say.
You're always one miscalculation, one small edge catch or mistiming of things away from what can be a life-threatening or career-ending injury or just you hurt your finger.
You know, there's part of me that, you know, at one stage thought it might be a really good idea that you, you know, choose another sport. But then again, you know, who am I to talk? I'm the sort of person that would just say go for it, and I'm not going to let my fears get in the way of, you know, what she really loves doing.
Well, you had a hamstring tendon repair.
Yeah.
Any problems?
Yeah, so at 3 months, that's when I got patellar tendonitis.
I think it's a little bit scary every time Annabel calls. You're a little bit on edge, just waiting for something to be wrong. But I think Mum deals with it quite well.
And now pull up towards your face. Good, good, good. Hard as you can, hard as you can.
I remember once she was sobbing and she said, I've hurt my knee and the doctor thinks, you know, I've torn my ACL.
And they're the ligaments that stop the shin bone from moving on the thigh bone. Annabel tore her anterior cruciate ligament in her knee.
And let's have a look at your ankles.
And when it tears, it's gone for good. You don't get another one.
It stops me from, like, having a normal gait.
So in order to be able to compete again or even walk normally again or ski properly again, you have to have it repaired.
And who's this little guy?
He's a turtle. He reminds me to slow down.
Took it to the surgeon and he said, you know, it's a complete rupture, so you're going to need surgery and probably a year off skiing. And she was gutted and so was I. I got up in the morning and I heard this clump, clump, clump down the hallway with her crutches. And I thought, uh-oh. And she came in and she said, Mum, I've been thinking. And I said, what? She said, I think if I have the operation and do everything that the doctors tell me, I can come back even stronger. And I went, that's my girl.
It's been about a month now since my relapse and things have been a lot better, but there was definitely a time where that wasn't the case. Ready or not, could this be true? I made a little film on how desperate I was to get back on snow.
And I realised at that point that she had watched me her whole life. She had watched me fall over and get up so many times that it was just natural for her to do the same thing. She did all her rehab and, true to her word, look where she is now.
Annabel is fairly new to the international competition scene. Her first World Cup was here in New Zealand this winter, and I know she got a top 15 finish. Annabel's got great style.
She's just made the Winter Olympic squad for Sochi next year, but the final team isn't announced till 2 weeks before the Olympics, so she won't find out until mid-January.
I've been in Cadrona in the South Island of New Zealand for 2 weeks training at a spring camp.
Oh, it's cold.
So cold.
Do you want to go for some flat throughs? Does that make you pop more?
Yeah, probably.
Yeah.
Skiing with Anna Siegel, who's the number one in Australia.
Wow. That's it.
And I was sort of tagging along behind her and her coach, Tori Beatty. I don't have a coach.
Your down rail was super nice. Athletes commonly use an ice bath to recover their muscles after exercise, but we're quite fortunate here in Wanaka. We have a beautiful lake. So they will go down and stand in there for about 20, 25 minutes, much to the amusement of onlookers.
I'm definitely way more of a wimp than she was. Whenever she was turned around and wasn't watching me, I'd be like, oh my God, it's freezing. And then she'd turn around and be like, yep, everything's cool. And then she'd turn around and I'm like, ah, oh, it's so cold.
Hello.
It's really hot here.
Glad to be back.
Yeah.
So from now until February, I have 3 World Cups to go to. So up until then, all I can do is my best, try my hardest, kind of leave nothing on the table.
You didn't lose anything?
I think it's a perception for people when they hear about Annabel making the team. Oh, great, you know, well, she's living your life. She's living the dream. She's completing your dream. And I said, well, you know, I mean, I say, no, that's not the case at all. I'm not invested in her dream.
And then 2 weeks and then my first World Cup and then Christmas and another week and a bit and then another World Cup. Mum is as supportive as anyone could ever be, and she's enhanced my experience of competing and sport and skiing, and I will be really happy to share it with my mum if I get there. But I don't feel a need to get there because of my mum.
Living with a disabled parent is difficult for some children. The Shepherd children have understood what it's like to be around people who are less than perfect, and they are empathetic.
I'm currently just about to finish my first year of studying medicine at Monash University down here in Melbourne. I guess when I was younger, I really got to see a lot the influence that sort of the medical society had on our family's life. I mean, Mum's sort of been always been in and out of appointments and that sort of thing, and some of the doctors she had when she was first in hospital are some of her best friends.
It's really interesting that Charlotte's gone into medicine. I thought, well, maybe, you know, she's going to come up with a cure for spinal cord injury. I think she's going to be a great doctor one day. I've been a single mum now for over 10 years. There were problems within the marriage, and it was really untenable. And it was 3 years of really struggle. So I became depressed. And I thought, that can't be me, I can't be depressed. I felt like I was living two lives. There was the Janine that was out there speaking, you know, on the speaking circuit.
A full human experience is about every single emotion.
Inspiring and motivating people, and I would come home and life was in disarray, so I felt like I was living a lie.
Okay, for Martin.
It was an interesting period of my life. I've got to the point now where both of the girls have left home and Angus is now living with his father. I remember waking up and thinking, you know, there's no lunches to make, there's no one to drive to school, what do I do with myself? And Annabel said to me, you know, Mum, why don't you go back into the spinal ward? I have all the, you know, the issues that all spinal cord patients, or most, have anyway, which is bladder and bowel, which is probably the worst part, you know, self-catheterising and et cetera, et cetera. And having those things has also enabled me to connect with other people with spinal cord injuries, because I get it. I know what it's like.
What I think is interesting about the spinal ward is that you realise that accidents and injury don't discriminate.
I have noticed how much she not hides, but keeps from other people and puts on a brave face.
You know, underneath all of this, we're all the same, aren't we? We're all connected, so.
And I see what other people see, and she's completely normal, and she's happy, and she's strong. But then I come back home, and she lives with these injuries every day, and she's in pain every day.
Hey, hello, how are you? It's good to see you.
She does have, you know, certain disabilities that people sometimes forget because she is so amazing and resilient and doesn't show it. But I guess I just have to appreciate at times where maybe she needs a break or a rest.
The miracle, actually, of a lot of what happens in this program is actually everybody connecting and feeling that they're not alone.
I've been working on a program on resilience with a friend of mine, Luella, who's a doctor, that we could introduce into the spinal ward and also oncology wards.
But with awareness of that process...
Yes, exactly.
..you can step back from that and you know that, you know, I'm just working through this.
There is a possibility for an exceptional life after this, for a rich and meaningful life. And, you know, the great paradox of life is that it can be unbearably cruel and breathtakingly wondrous at the same time. You know, and life is not about having it all, it's about loving it all. And I think there's hope in that. There's hope in that message. And that's a message that I want to take to the world.
It's time we shed our focus on the physical and instead embrace the virtues of the heart.
You can definitely hear too much motivation. Sometimes you're like, oh, Mum, just let me be upset for a day. It's relentless. I mean, exactly what you hear like on stage, you hear that for 30 minutes. I get that every second.
And that's when we need to remember that we don't heal from running from our pain, we heal from living through our experience.
Make sense?
I'm sorry, I shouldn't be laughing, but that was so lame.
Oh, thanks.
Don't tell her this, but I don't listen to a lot of what she says.
No, that was more than one word.
I take the bits that I'm going to find useful, and the rest. It's a lot to take sometimes, but I wouldn't have it any other way.